We have been there working on various development issues for almost 45 years, and today our programs are spread out in 15 states of India. The first program we started with was dairy animal production, and that continues to be one of our largest programs today. We reach out to almost 4.5 million farmers, providing services of artificial insemination of dairy animals. And I have pioneered the use of frozen semen technology at the farmer's doorstep. And for that, we put in place a delivery system which was based on a motorcycle-based cryogenic chain, which was delivered by a technician to the remotest hut where even roads were not there. So that has resulted in almost more than 3 million farmers directly getting services from our network. And as you can see, there is a very large income flow that goes into the rural areas, which is directly out of our programs. We also work on many other programs. The goat development program, which we have started, reaches out to about 75,000 families. And we work on watershed development and a program in tribal areas, which is based on a farming system approach, which involves agriculture, horticulture, forestry, and natural resource management together. Though I will be talking mainly about goat development, let me just in passing also mention that one very important point which Dr. Joshi made in the morning, that in India, the dairy husbandry activity is primarily now with the small farmers. The small farmers, the marginal farmers, and what is happening is that the livestock, the number of livestock that they own is also increasing. And there are a number of facets to this which I think we must take note of. Number one is that the agriculture, the crop production by itself cannot make the farming enterprise viable anymore because of the fragmentation of land. And therefore, the livestock is getting added as part of the farming system to make it. And so there is an increasing trend towards livestock husbandry with the small farmers. The second is that we have found that for small farmers, livestock is the best drought-proofing mechanism. And not only it is a drought-proofing mechanism, in the present climate change situation where there are a lot of erratic fluctuations in the year-to-year climate, we find that livestock gives a resilience to the farmer. And all these farming systems are composite farming systems. They are not only livestock husbandry, they are composite farming systems, and they are primarily roughage-based feeding. So I think that these are some very important facets of the Indian dairy sector which are worth noting, particularly in the light of the discussions we had in the morning about a lot of emphasis on industrial production of livestock, which may lead to a lot of environmental problems, which as it has happened in many other locations, and which may also lead to a tremendous pressure on use of grain, diverting grain for taking care of the livestock. Anyway, let me get back to the main point. Goats in India are an important livestock. The population is 128 million. That's almost 20% of the world population. And in spite of having very large slaughter rates, 38%, rather high mortality rate, 15%, still the annual growth rate has been 1.6%. So the cumulative growth over 40 years has been 145% in goats. And the goat rearing is an excellent activity for low resource farmers. Firstly, it is a highly liquid asset. It can be disposed of very easily. It is very divisible, because if you have a goat herd of 10, you can sell one for your immediate need, or if you want your daughter to be married, you can sell all 10 of them. And so, it is like a saving bank for the poor. There is a rapid capital appreciation compared to many other livestock, and it is very easily managed by women. The input requirements are relatively low. And this is the last point, is something which is very interesting, because we did not expect that as an answer when we did a survey asking women why they wanted a goat. And we found that they said it has nothing to do with economics. They said that when the husband is away, or when there is nobody at home and only the woman is there, or only the kids are there, then the goat is a very good companion. Our goat development project has been going on in a number of states, in Rajasthan, in West Bengal, in Gujarat, in Orissa, and in Jharkhand. With ILRI, we are collaborating presently. The work is going on in Rajasthan, in Udaipur, and in Jharkhand. Of course, there are a large number of different breeds. These are only some of them which are there in our program. What we find as a situation in the field is that there is a low productivity. Even though goats population is so high and so many poor families keep them, the productivity is very low. There is a lot of inbreeding. The breeds are static, and in fact they are deteriorating, and there are high mortality rates. And the factors behind these are also very easy to comprehend. Low productivity because of degraded commons, not adequate grazing lands available, inbreeding because there hasn't been an emphasis on quality breeding inputs or breed improvements, static breeds because there is not much sustained work on breed improvement, and high mortality because there is hardly any health cover, there is a very high parasitic load, and there is no support available. So this is the situation in the field, and that immediately prompts us what are the needs of the field areas. Because the goats are primarily nondescript, there is a need for breed improvement. Because the awareness on management is so poor, you need a very important technology transfer program, and for that you require a very good, friendly, farmer-friendly extension service. The scarcity of feed and fodder has to be tackled, because just relying on the existing decreasing and degrading commons is not going to be enough. And there has to be preventive and promotive health programs. And there has to be better market literacy if after the production they are going to make some money out of it. So looking at these needs in the field, our whole program was evolved into a package program. So there was a breed improvement input that our program made possible. That was by inducting some specific breeds which are very well known and which have a good market demand, like the Sirohi in Rajasthan, the Black Bengal in Bengal and Eastern India, and there is another breed which is actually not recognized in India as a breed as yet. It is Sindhi breed, it is from the border, it is from actually across the border in Pakistan, which we have introduced in very dry desert conditions in Bademir. So depending on the location, depending on the situation, one needs to introduce the right breed. And it is not enough to just think of introducing the breed, because there is a tremendous shortage of bucks. And so you require a buck rearing program. Then in order to have a good extension mechanism in place, what we thought was the best way was to have community level resource persons. So the Bakri Mitra is basically a community level resource person who provides a number of services and support to the families. But not just one service provider, you also organize the producers into small groups. Because the small groups brings about a lot of vitality into the whole program. There is a lot of exchange, a lot of sharing, there is a lot of learning mutually. And then as per the requirement, those groups can be federated into a Bakri Sangathan, which is an apex body. But along with this, for fodder security, we also did a number of things. Like Jagdish was saying, where common lands are available, but of course they have not been so well productive, we have gone in for silvipasture development programs, which would make available browsable fodder as well as grasses for livestock. And we have also introduced various other things like azolla production, introducing other unconventional feed into the goat feeding and so on. Also, we found that in many places the mortality was high because there was absolutely no health preventive health cover available. So we had to introduce vaccinations, we introduced deworming almost everywhere, and of course the deworming, in order that it should not be indiscriminate, we had to go in for, as we have done with the ILRI project, analysis of the fecal samples and then deciding what type of deworming should be done, and tick control. So these health measures also make a lot of difference to the birth weights as well as the growth of the goats. And the other important thing we saw was that it was middlemen who would come into the villages and who would buy, who would just say, this goat I'll give you 500 rupees for this goat I'll give you 400, and that used to be the way the transactions took place. So we had to, we saw that if you make the people more market literate, understanding what are the market prices for the meat, then what is the ratio of the live meat to the meat as it's sold, and then telling them how to estimate the weight of their goat. So first we introduce weighing scales, then we introduce girth measurements, and so that awareness itself though even though traders may not buy on live weight basis, as we have discovered in the Ilri project, in spite of a lot of stakeholder interaction, even then the farmers can negotiate better. So this whole thing became a technology package. Vaccination, dewormers, fecal sample analysis, using castrators to castrate the scrub bucks in the village, introducing fodder trees on bunds so that there is some additional fodder resource available, introducing wild pods into the feeding. So these are not the common feed that get into for the goats, introducing first aid kits. And the last one, again very interesting, we found that with farmers who had, we have also frozen goat semen, and we found that there are farmers who also have dairy animals, and when they have dairy animals they have some goats also, but they won't keep a buck because then there is an odor which comes into the milk if you have a buck, and then that milk doesn't sell well. So they would avoid a buck, and therefore there was a demand for artificial insemination of goats also. So that also we had done in some areas where it was a combination of dairy animals and goats. So on the whole, a number of good management practices have suggested themselves out of this experience, that we need to avoid inbreeding, we have to introduce bucks, and if we are introducing bucks, we have to also keep on exchanging them between, that's where the groups come in handy. So one group can exchange its buck. Also a larger induction of bucks gives a better genetic diversity. So avoiding inbreeding is important. Then formation of activity groups helps in, as I said earlier, cohesiveness, mutual learning, negotiation skills, shared resources, and so that is something which is very important. It is also important to demystify knowledge and technology. And that's where the community resource persons plays a very key role, because that is a knowledge that becomes a practice knowledge which stays with the community even when a project ends. And there is also need to institutionalize a number of services. A number of these I already mentioned, but some things which I did not mention, like the insurance coverage, microfinance linkages, because if somebody is to start a goat rearing, then there is an initial dose of capital that is required. And one of the institutionalization of stakeholder interaction, which is being done right now in this project, which is called the innovation platform, is also noteworthy. The innovation platform is a stakeholders forum. It involves producers, it involves input service providers, it involves traders, and it therefore becomes a nodal point for knowledge transfer and exchange, and becomes a forum for sharing and planning. The community resource person does a number of different things. As I mentioned, apart from, sometimes they also maintain a buck and provide the breeding service. They also carry out mass vaccination and deworming. They do home visits when there are new families getting inducted. So they are, good management practices are demonstrated there and then. They administer first aid and so on. So many of these services are paid services, and so it becomes a sustainable availability with the community. The innovation platform, because of the interactions between these three groups, could also throw up a lot of important ideas. So there were a number of needs that were identified by the producers, number of them by the service providers as well as the traders, and that helped to bring it and a mutual appreciation of all these things. So various innovative ideas came up, like fattening of kids can be a program, sub-program that can be taken up. Buck rearing can be a special program that can be taken up. Reduction in feed cost by introducing non-conventional feed can be help to augment fodder resources. Plantation of fodder trees, azolla production, these are various things that have been introduced in our field programs. These are some examples of, I won't go into this, you are all familiar with what it means to do goat development. So, as I said, we reach out to about 75,000 farmers in all these different states. The impacts are phenomenal. The kidding rates have gone from 2 to 3, birth weights have increased, body weight gain has been great, and in some areas where mortality was very high at 30 plus, it has come down to 5%. Fodder availability has increased, milk production also was available from the goats, and per doe income has increased as a result. So these are some examples from a particular project area. Like here, for one kid, from 1.5 kg it went to 2.5 kg body weight at the time of birth, and so on. So the learnings are that we have to, of course, give this as a package service. The second is that there are seasonalities in demand, and we have to match the production for that. Then There are specific breeds which would be in more demand, so one has to have a good sense of the market. Then groups, cooperatives, all that is very important. And the whole, some sort of a community level organization has to emerge. These are challenges we faced on husbandry, on marketing, and the emergent needs that come out is that intensive work production programs are required, regular health services required, insurance, microfinance. This breed conservation genetic improvement programs probably are not there as many as required. We have identified a number of innovative studies that could be taken up out of all this field experience, and there are policy implications. For the program design, there are implications that there should be a holistic program design which covers breeding to market linkages. There has to be a backward integration of supply of bucks and vaccines. We have to facilitate shift to stall feeding. For that, the augmentation of different types of fodder resources is important, and promoting organized markets is also very important. And there are also a lot of policy support that may be required in the interest of goat husbandry in the future. So this is out of our experience. Thank you very much.